Thank you. So our today's agenda is the main one, the data version control, as well as the model tracking part. So this data version control, it's also almost similar with Git. And the model tracking, or the one which we are using, we will going to use this on this session, is the MLflow, so which can help us to track model runs. So what are the changes? And how can we figure out whether they are changed or not? So they will tell us the overall information about each and every runs which we are performing or which we are going through model development. So the main thing which we is discussing in this session is about like knowing about this data version control system and the outcome for this session, and a bit about this model tracking part. So data version control system is almost as the name indicates, it's a data version control system, or it's a tool which can help us to track our data change, and which can inform us what type of changes are made to our data and how can we store our data. And most of the time this gives provides us this code version control system for our software package. So we're able to track each and every commits which we are performing on our codes using the Git. And the idea is similar with Git, the DBC idea. So almost it is the replica of this Git, but the main difference between Git is Git mainly focus on the code versioning part, and DBC focus on data versioning aspects. So if we say that data version DBC is a data version control system, so how can it control our data and keep our change? Like you can think of your envelope as a Git repository, and you will put everything inside that, your scripts, your YAML files, and everything related to your model. However, if you want to have a model which is beyond the Git capacity, you are not able to store that file on GitHub. The main reason which we need this data version control system is sometimes Git doesn't allow us to store a lot of files in terabits or in gigabits. So because of this, we should have to have certain alternative mechanisms. So Git's come to solve this problem. And to start with DBC, you can start by simply installing this DBC on your environment, by install DBC, or if you are using Conda or VS Code, just install that in your machine. Then you have this marvelous functionality from the data version control system. So why we need this DBC? The first is for data versioning. So we have, while we are running our models, we have most a dynamic environment in which is changing from time to time. So we should have to rerun our model, we should have to rerun our feature extraction mechanism, we should have to almost recollect our data from, or we should have to add additional data which is on the existing data. So the each and every change, regardless of your data, can be captured by the DBC, and this DBC will store a meta file, which is a data about data, and it will be stored in your Git repository, so you can easily access your data from the Git by mentioning the point with where your data is stored, either in remote or in your local machine. So it is according to your needs. So if you want to store your model on the G drive or S3 bucket or on your local machine, DVC can have this type of opportunity for you to store your data set. And it will give you also a tracking information about your data. So the why we need these data sets, we should have to, in order to have this versioning advantage as well as storage. Then the last one is this DVC is almost compatible with all environments. Like you can implement DVC with Scala, you can implement DVC with Java, you can implement DVC with Python. And also for those like Linux users or Windows users, hat users, Mac users, all of them can use seamlessly this DVC. So this is the other advantage which we get while we are using this DVC. So basically there are the commands which is related to this DVC are similar with the one which you are using your Git. So some of the command, like you can instantiate your folder by typing Git init, or you can instantiate your DVC by DVC init. So almost they are similar, but instead of this Git, you can replace with this DVC when you need the DVC functionality. So I have added some README on my repo, so I can show you that and how I am using them for creating my DVC repo in my DVC storage in my local file, local machine. So I think it's visible. So yeah. To start with this DVC, you should have to first initialize this Git part. So you should have to commit this. You should have to type Git init in your Git bash. Then, if you are using this Linux, you can use the deck terminal. So then, after that, if you have instantiated your repository, then you should have to add the Git functionality, then to, DVC functionality. So to add this DVC functionality, you can use this DVC init. Then the next step is to configure your remote file storage space. So here I have selected my own machine, so I have created a DVC remote storage for my data set in temp DVC storage. So this should show you when did I create my instead of this, you can use like G drive, then your folder address will be tested here. Then you can access directly your data from G drive as well as. And also you can replace this one with this S3 bucket. So basically, once you have set up these things, you are going to add your data set to your DVC in order to be trackable by the DVC tool. So basically, as we are using Git add in order to add data on our repository, so we are also similarly, we are using this Git add the data which is found under the data folder and which is called as winequality.csv. So it will add this to DVC. We are adding the to DVC, it will give us files, gitignore data as well as gitignore and data.winequality.csv.dvc file. So basically these two things are a junction for our DVC and Git file, because as I have said earlier, Git doesn't store our data set. So this Git ignore will have the address of our data set, and this the file which contains .dbc file, it contains the MD5 hashed value and your data set address. So lately you can access it as seamlessly from your storage to your GitHub repository. Then the next is just once you have added this one, it's already file is tractable, as it's not sent to the remote Git repository because the Git ignore file contains the information about it. So it will discard while you are pushing your course to GitHub, and it will open the DVC, .dvc file only. And this DVC can help us as a pointer for our data set. And we can get it from later for later usage. Then once you have finished setting up these things, you will gonna to commit your initial message for your initial data set, and also you should have to tag this data version because you are somebody may gonna to add additional data to this file, or somebody may have gonna to split this data. So to have those things, you should have to add the version information, because it may help you to translate the model performance as well as the model related issues. So basically, you can perform these actions on your machines. Then the final stage is to push your and to reflect it to your repository as well as to the public DBC structure. Then here I have added additional version of my data, which is almost chunked into, split into 100 data set, almost 100 rows, only select existing data, and they will, I have added them as Git version 2. So basically, when I'm pushing my data set, I have two data, which are the data set version 1 as well as version 2. Then the next is like you can check what is on your data set. So so in order to check that, I will go to my Git patch, and I will type this Git log, and it will show me what type of commits I have made and who have made that commits and when did it committed. Those things are visible for you in order to, like, just they are as a log information. Just wait.
Sorry,
me.
Mario, I'm not seeing your screen.
Yeah, just a connection issue. That's why I'm still waiting. So my Git bash shows me like this, and the commits which I made earlier. So as I have tagged as version 2 and version 1 from my data set. So I've put this into the origin master. So basically those information will give you almost a clear information about who created the DVC file or the .data file, and when it was created, and what type of tags it have and what are the specific commit instruction for that. So this information will be logged on your DVC file and as well as in your Git, so you can easily check out who made what and how, when. You can have this type of information while you are using this DVC. Then the next step is just to model or to train your model. So in order to train your model, yeah, you should have. Okay, Stacey, you can.
I want to ask about the versioning. If I want to create a version 2 and I want to do that using a condition without affecting the original data. So for example, if for the data set we have, I want to remove the people who didn't give any response, and then I want to save that as my version 2, how do I do that on the terminal?
You can put your instead. Just I think so, if it's better if you have filtered out everything at your notebook level than in your processing stage. So you should have to include your processing script on your folder. Then once you have finished that, you can able to add this to the DVC tool.
Okay.
So the next step is to model these data. So I have a small implementation on this modeling part. Any question? Okay, Varak.
Oh, one of the things that I want to ask is like what Kate has been asking.
I didn't hear you.
Kate has been asking, yeah. Install DVC on both and combine the Git or something like that. Nathaniel has given an answer, but one of the things that Nathaniel has given an answer for that. But my question is like, do we use two environments for our projects or just one environment? Like, there is a Conda environment which is
no. Just I'm putting this as an alternative because sometimes there may be an issue with pipe install. So if you are using Conda environment, I prefer to install my package using this Conda. But okay. It's depend upon your choice.
Yeah, the thing is that what I've been doing before is like I will have like some environments for to install scripts for the one for Python scripts, and I just use the Conda without installing script pip install, without using pip install. So should that matter, or just using only one environment variable as a base? Like when you use the base, it is just the general for the Conda as a whole. So when you install pip or when you pip install on it, it will be added to the whole Conda environment. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
you are. I think your question is to have a virtual environment on Conda or.
Yeah. So how we can accomplish that?
You can create new virtual environment on Conda, then it will be separated from the baseline. Then there are some commands out there. So immediately it will switch from your, once you have activated your Conda, it will be switched from the base to the newly created environment.
Thank you.
Okay. Stacey.
Okay, so after I filter in my notebook, I save it as a new CSV.
Yeah.
Before I send it to.
Okay. You have a new CSV file, which is processed CSV file. Okay. You will finish the pre-processing steps there. Then it's already cleaned and ready to be modeled.
Okay.
Okay. Any question? So let's get deep dive to this. Mikhail. Mike or Mike? Michael, you can go.
All right, yeah, so with, I'm with the answer to Stacy, that's so when you have saved your data, then you can use the DVC to send it. But with this, is there does this in a way replaces a feature store, and how do they relate to each other? Where you've created kind of a store where you take data, you put it in, and then you also take data from it, and then you feed it to your models. How do the DVC and then the feature store relates to each other?
To integrate those things, you can have like this. Let me answer for him. And the idea of this DVC is to have an index or to have a meta file for our data set. So by simply referring your index term, you can get your full data as well as you get your data tracking information. So the one and the only thing which we are using this DVC is to track our data information. So you should have to have this tracking information in your modeling part in order to help you to perform additional or to get information from your future store, as well as, for example, your future store building is an iterative. If you, let's say, if you have developed a model for online smart ad company, and the data is still, it's not static, so the data is dynamic, so you should have to collect each time, as well as you should have to have almost real-time implementation as well. So when things like that is happening, you should have to think of how do the coming data is affecting my overall data set, my feature sets, as well as my entire model flow. Then based on that, you can take your correct measure to have efficient modeling result for you. Okay, Stacey.
Just one last question.
Someone is raised in hand. Okay.
I was wondering, so this new CSV that I've filtered becomes my version 2?
Yes.
Okay.
Or else it will become your training data set.
Okay.
Okay, Babu. Are you there?
Yeah, sorry, I was speaking on mute.
Okay.
So when you use DVC to, you know, have the data about the data, and when you make a change to the data, and you kind of, do you record the record, you know, the history that you deleted or changed some value, or do you back up the data? Did you send, like, if you commit 3 or 4 times on the data, do you mean you will have 3, 4, or 5 copies of the data?
No, I should have to remain. Basically, I'm keeping the one which I'm going to use, and the others, the copy parts will be removed from the drive because they are taking too much memory. Even they are not useless.
Therefore, what we record is only just the history that we have added, that we have deleted, that, right?
We have this one. This is performed by this guy or this machine, and at this time, and it have added these things. The log information will have this information for you, and yeah. It was able you to have some when some sort of inconvenience comes, you go back and trace where the problem is to make things easy.
I don't think that, I mean, the way I understand it, I don't make that makes things easy. For example, using a variable for different kind of transaction or different kind of analysis is easier and better for me. For instance, if I wanted to drop two or three columns in a data, then I can I can have a new variable. I can assign the columns I want in that data set in this new variable, and I can continue my work with that variable instead of changing the actual data or the, my first variable of the data.
Just think of production. You can think of like production, and in production way, you don't have to write your variables, everything in there. So basically, it's known that you have finished already your pre-processing stuffs and related things, and your data should have to pass those steps. Then after that, you have already ready-made data. So that data will be stored in your DVC to further track your information. If I am clear for that.
Let me reiterate a bit on his question. Imagine in a situation where you're building different models, or you're building the same models and you have to create iteration of the same model. You're going to have to keep a track of the data that you have and the data that you've been using through the values, because each particular data set is going to produce a different performance in the model. If you have version one, you can gauge the performance that version one gave you. And then if you have version two, you're going to gauge what version two gave you. So it's not really about just storing the data and having the data there. You can be able to get which particular data brings which particular result. Gezachu, did I answer your question? I mean, sorry for interrupting, Marlet. Okay, cool.
Okay, so is there any question? If not, let us go to the modeling part, and the modeling part will start from the ML flow, or the one which we are using for model tracking purpose. So as we have gone through modeling in the past 2 weeks, so we have basic understanding about how to model, how to give parameters to our model. So beyond that, we should have to almost think of how our model are acting and how, what that the results related to our model. So the next is this ML flow. And this ML flow is one of the MLOps tools, which is almost open source tool, which can help us to track as well as to package our models. And also for model registering also, we are using this ML flow. So, the basic four components which is provided by this ML flow is like the first one is model tracking, or in conducting these experiments on your data set and having all related outputs towards your data sets, and also packaging your model, which we call it as a project. So you have a certain umbrella package, and you will put all your models as well as your script there, and it will package that. And the model part will be help us to deploy our ML projects. So the deployment environment will be the Conda, or the Docker file, or the one which we are using, the simple model deployment in ML flow. So you can specify, we can have this type of model deployment mechanisms. Then the last one is model registry, based on their parameters and what they have taken in their training paths. And even the trained model will be saved there. So MLflow can provide us this advantage for the MLOps pipeline. So we can have like a lot of models as well as this a container environment, the data set parameters, hyperparameters, and reproduction. So all these things can be traced by this MLflow. And the main challenge which raised this MLflow is the first one, it's difficult to keep track of your experiment information. So your result as well as your metrics, parameters, your outputs. Sometimes you can reproduce this image and others from the models as a model output. So it's difficult to keep track of those things. And also it's difficult to reproduce the code or because the packaging issue. And according to every environment, this package and deployment stuff is different. When you are using this MLflow for deployment, you can follow different structure. When you are using the Docker part, you can use different step. And when you are using this Heroku or any other deployment structure, so they have their own structure as well, because in order to have certain standardized model deployment or model packaging mechanism, we use this MLflow. And also for the need for the central store to manage our models and version and the stage in transition, everything related to our model will be needs to be stored in certain central database, and we can enable to access that. So from this ML model comp that I've talked about each of them. So when we are implementing this ML flow, we can have different structure, but the one and the only thing is just importing your ML flow, then by instantiating this. And the next is the main, just to show you the main functionality which I've added this ML flow. In here, I have splitted my data into training and testing, and then some sort of cleaning stuffs. And here is the start of your MLflow. So MLflow will start to run at this step, and it will accept your model name, any model name. Either I have used this ElasticNet for regression model, but XGBoost or random tree, decision tree classifier, or random forest regressor, any model, machine learning model with their parameters will be applicable in MLflow start run. So it will accept the model, it will install the model, then you will going to apply just that to the training set as well as to the test. The final is to have these are special functions which allows help us to save the model parameters, model metrics, what are the results processed by this model, and also the tracking UI. And having this, while you are running this file, you will have automatically created this ML run folder on your repository. And this ML runs will contain every run results And here I have run in two times with version, so the meta files will be there. And so model metrics and everything related to that stuff will be stored here, and it will your ML UI will be able to read this ML run. So I can run this on my local website, local browser. So just to simulate that, it is the pre-trained. So here the experiment and log information will be loaded to the interactive UI or something, you can call it like dashboard. So it's runs through this ML flow UI. So I have run the DVC experiment as well as DVC with random forest. For now, I don't think it's working, but previously I have run it. So here, as you see, it's a start time who will commit this one and the source file and also the version, then the model, everything, parameters, metrics related to that run will be recorded here. So individually you can have a look at like this. So there are the parameters which I have used for training my model and also anything related to my model will be stored here. If pictures and model information, metadata, and those will gonna be stored here in the artifact folder. Then it's also this MLflow can allow you to compare different models with different parameters. If then let me show you one comparison between different parameters, and also I think they are in. You can see that the performance for the mean square error and mean absolute square error, as well as the error square error, or they have different on the different data set, because those data set I didn't write the versions in the parameters, but if we run with versions, you can get the version information as well as that. Alternatively, I have run both of them at the same time, that's why it shows you somehow not significant number, but by changing these parameters you can have different results. And this is the model for random forest regression. Okay, it doesn't have. So the idea behind this MLflow is to have this easy tracking for your experiments. So I hope it was clear, and if you have any doubt, I can explain more. But it's the additional flavor which I didn't show you here in the MLflow UI, you can compare different models. So you can have she have used. Even you can add more models there. So this was the idea behind MLflow, and you can have the information, every information while you are mouse hovering in the scatter plot, or you can have this, you can change everything regardless of your metrics or parameters here in the dashboard. So I hope it was helpful, and if you have any question, welcome. Okay, Mike.
All right. So with this, if you are running, let's say, random search, will it keep every parameter or inputs that you would have for each of the models, each run that the random search would have?
Sorry, I'm muted. By means of this random search, you are going to apply this cross-validation, yes?
Sure.
Yeah, it will recur.
Okay.
And best model parameter will be will be used for the prediction purpose.
Yes. So so which means that if every run of a model in a script would be recorded by the MLflow, whether it is encapsulated in maybe a random search, or whether it is running on its own, it will still be recorded in the MLflow.
Yeah, this MLflow will help you to record that. So it will record, or else you can limit your records only to have the best params, the models which have best params only. You can limit that.
Okay, if that is available, that I think that will be a fair deal. Thanks.
Okay. So, any other?
Stacy, I think.
Okay, Stacy.
So this metrics, I believe, are for the developer to compare models. So I was wondering what is it that we deploy? So for example, in that exercise, what is it that we'll be deploying?
You will going to deploy your best model using Docker or this MLflow. Just to predict for the coming new results, the coming new data values.
Okay.
Like, for example, if you want to have certain websites which can predict user experience, so based on what user stays, how much time did this user stay here in our website, and that all those things will be as an input for your model. Then it will try to predict the result based on that. Either he will engage on your whatever thing you have provided on your website or not. That type of prediction will be performed after you have deployed your model, and you will extend this either using this Streamlit or any other web application, or Flask or Django. To extend that into your into the working scenario, or else you can use as your desktop app. Stacey, I'm clear. So, any question regardless? I have heard one question from. Who is his name? I didn't remember, but have you got the answer, the difference between this machine learning, A-B testing, as well as statistical A-B testing? What's the difference between this machine learning and statistical A-B testing? Anyone?
Please come again.
What's the difference between machine learning, A-B testing, and I think it was Mr. Samuel or Sam's question. Yes.
Come proceed. It was me that asked that question. So far as I understand it, in the machine learning based A-B testing, we use the data that we have to predict the response of each user. And once we have a model that is good at predicting, we check how much each feature contributes to answering that question. So if our experiment contributes larger than the other variables, then that means the other features, it means that our new design, or the design that the feature that we're going to test is passing, and if it's not, it fails, I guess. That's as far as I got, but I wish I could understand more if there is anything else.
Yeah, and just I have understood some, so I just wanted to share you. That's why I'm asking the question, if anyone have any idea, and we'll just discuss it here to have clear out understanding about that. Anyone, the difference between machine learning A-B testing as well as statistical A-B testing? What's mean by baseline? I didn't understand. But while you are performing your A-B testing, just you are going to compare your either exposed or control group towards your output. So does it comes by lag, or does it comes if this result is statistically significant or not? You can have this this type of explanation while you are performing this A-B testing. But the one and the only limitation for this statistical A-B testing is you are comparing your either exposed or control groups with the output. Basically, the real world data is not like that, because we have different user behaviors. We have from you can think of user behavior like their age, or their gender, or their interest, or the time they spend in our website, the clicks they are going, touch, everything should have impact on the last output. rather than either just checking this statistically, saying this is statistically significant, to what extent our futures are favored for this output. We should have to know this in brief. So we have this ML-based A/B testing, so that can it's based on those all features. So you will give your machine learning every features you have from the users, and it will start to check the future importance based on that. These features is mostly favors for your output, and this feature may help you if you improve this type of features. You are able to get more customers, or this type of decision will be made by your ML-based A/B testing rather than this statistical A/B testing. For ML-based A/B testing, you will calculate this feature importance. Then based on that, this is significant to, this is favorable to your output, or significant for the desired output or not. Based on that, you will decide. Anything? So let us wrap up here, and if you have any question, you can message on the Rocket chat and we'll try to help, and the whole team will going to help you. For the classical method, Barakat, I didn't see yours, but you will use either z-score or p-values for the significance.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, so like when we determine the practical significance, I think it's from the business perspective, I think, yeah? So
yes.
Is it how much significant is it for the business? We say this part of it is we will accept this new feature. So how we are going to determine this thing from the given data set? Like most of the time they use like 2%, 5% in some blogs that I read, but on our thing, is it 10%? Like how we are going to
most of the time thing? The rule of thumb is just to have 95% confidence interval. You will going to be tolerated to 0.5 error rate.
Yeah, so when we calculate the like the statistical significance, we could use like 95% or like 95% of like what do we say? Statistical significance.
And for the 5%, maybe it will be tolerable.
So, what about the from the business perspective? Like, how do we specify, like from the given data, how do we know? Like if the company wants to know which percent is most significant, like we say minimum detectable effect, we specify the minimum detectable effect, yeah? So how
yes.
We are going to specify the minimum detectable effect from the business perspective? Like when we calculate the significance from the statistical significance, like getting the data and calculating the mean square and like having a mean square deviation from the mean is like the statistical significance. So how do we specify the from the business perspective, like if the business should accept this percentage or not? Like it differs from like from project to project or from features to features. So you know, what's the best way to do that?
I'm not quite sure, but I think so. It's the main thing is it's because it's dependent on your problem, but the significance level is almost based on your either on Discord data or p-value data, and based on that, there are some thresholds, which is the confidence interval one, for example, 1.6 is not significant for your case, or for example, if the confidence interval is 2.01, it's based on, it's completely dependent on your problem, and you should have to figure out that in that way.
Okay.
Thank you, and we'll meet soon. Bye.